In the spring of 1992, my family moved into an old farmhouse in rural Oswego, Illinois. I was 7 at the time. The house had been built in 1859 by the Harvey family and was added onto in 1910. The strange occurrences began the night we moved in. At 3 a.m., my father awoke to strange noises downstairs. He found that all the lights had been turned on and the chairs had been stacked onto the dining room table. Often my mother would awake to the sounds of crying children. As she stepped into the hallway, the crying would always stop, and my brother and I would always be sleeping. My parents would also wake late at night to the tolling of a grandfather clock. We didn't own one, but discovered that one used to be in the house many years before. The house had an old second staircase that had been sealed away into the walls many years before. You could see the bottom of the steps when the basement door was open when you looked up. We often heard slow, heavy footsteps moving up and down them. In the summer of 1992, my friend Alan would often spend the night at our house on the weekends. One week he just stopped coming over, even though I kept inviting him. 6 years later, when we were in junior high school together, he told me the reason why. He said that the last time he came over, he had awoken to a figure in the doorway of my bedroom. Thinking it was my father, he put on his glasses to see what he wanted. He said that he saw a man dressed in a Civil War uniform staring back at him. After a few seconds, the figure disappeared. I wouldn't have come back either. On a Saturday afternoon in 1992, my entire family was watching TV in the den. The first sign that something was wrong was when our Rottweiler, Abby, got up off the floor, looked directly at the ceiling, and started growling. We saw a spinning white mist form near the ceiling. Abby went crazy, and the room got bitterly cold. We didn't know what to think. At about this time, my father started researching the house and later discovered some old photographs in the basement that had been left in a filing cabinet. The photos were from 19th century funerals that had been held in our home. Through his research, my dad discovered that at least 3 people had died in the house due to natural causes over the years. He also found out the house was built and lived in for several generations by the Harvey family of Oswego. The Harveys were well known in the area for starting one of the first threshing rings. Apparently, they brought together all of the steam-powered farming implements they had and harvested local crops much more quickly than a single family could. In 1993, my own personal experiences started to increase. That summer, I spent every single day playing Sega Genesis in an upstairs gaming room that my parents had set up. Apparently, it had been used as a nursery in the past and was very small. Everything began normally enough, but as the summer wore on, I began to feel uneasy in the room. I often felt as if someone was watching me. I kept seeing things out of the corner of my eye. But when I looked, there was nothing there. I then began to feel a presence in the room. Over the days, the presence began to move closer to me. I vividly remember the day I felt it directly behind me. I stood up, threw the controller on the ground, and quickly left the room without looking back. After that, I never again went back into that room willingly. I became so frightened that I was reluctant to go upstairs at night anymore. I'm not joking when I say that when it was time to go to bed, my father would stand at the bottom of the stairs and count off with me to let me know he was still there. 1, 1, 2, 2, etc. One Saturday night in 1994, I was at home with my brother and our babysitter, Liz. We were watching TV and wanted to make some popcorn. We had an ancient microwave that required pulling up on a latch to open it. It couldn't be opened without pulling up on this metal latch. After placing the popcorn in it and closing it, we went back to the TV. Very shortly afterwards, we heard the microwave opening with a crash. We stood around somewhat dumbfounded and Liz reset it. Again, it reopened by itself. It happened one more time and flung open so loudly that Liz screamed and took us outside of the house. We waited on the driveway for about an hour until my parents came home from their evening out. We ended up moving out shortly after, not because of the haunting, but because the house needed rewiring and would have cost a fortune. Sure enough, a familiar scene played out during our last night in the house. My father came downstairs late at night to find the lights on, fans running, and chairs stacked up on the dining room table again. Fast forward to May 2016. I'm 30 years old and living in Arizona. I came home to the Chicago area for my grandfather's 90th birthday party. It was a good time and I got to see everyone in my extended family. On my last day there, it was a Sunday I remember, I took my brother and his girlfriend out to breakfast. I can't remember her name as they're no longer together. Either way, as we were driving home, we passed our old house. My brother wanted me to pull over so he could get out and see it. I didn't really feel like it, but they were so enthusiastic that I turned the truck around and parked. We opened the gate and walked up to the house. Sure enough, the owners were home and were more than happy to give us a tour of our old childhood house. My folks had sold the house to an older couple in the same sports club as them, and they had remembered us. When we entered the house, I was actually excited to be there. It had the same feel and that same old smell I remembered as a kid. We toured the downstairs first, and the new owner told us that the old sealed-off staircase had collapsed, and they ended up opening up that area. We went upstairs next and saw my brother's room first, and then my old room. All was fine at this point. We turned down the main hallway and I stepped into a spare room that was around the corner from the old gaming room. In that room, I smelt an overwhelming stench of death and decay. I can't even adequately express just how overcoming it was. It was still there, and it wanted me to know it was there. My brother and his girlfriend both gave me a strange look when I came out, and his girlfriend would later tell me that my face had turned white. I don't really remember the rest of the tour, I was in a daze, but I do remember how horrified I felt. When we got outside, the mood lifted. The owner was burning trash in an old silo, and we joked with him about how we used to do the same thing when we lived there. Adam's girlfriend suggested we get a picture in front of our old home. She took one with my phone and then another with Adam's. We thanked the old couple, waved goodbye, and went back to her parents' place. I was still shaken up for hours after getting home thinking about that smell. Shrugging it off, I decided to see how the photo of the house had turned out. I zoomed the image and was horrified at what I saw. There was a face staring down at us from my old bedroom window. I forwarded the photo to my brother immediately and asked him if he noticed anything unusual about the photo on his phone. Sure enough, there was another face looking down at us, and it was even more frightening than the one in my photo. The face in my photo just appeared to be staring at us, but the face in his photo was grinning with malicious glee. I don't know what's in that house or why it's there, but I'll never go back in there again, ever. Well, my dear friends, I hope you enjoyed that true tale sent in by one of my viewers, who goes by the name of Joe. That is his name. He only wants me to reveal his first name, not his second family name for obvious reasons. He sent that in some time ago when I was still on Facebook, and I finally got round to doing it. And, well, if it does okay, I'll be doing some more readers' tales. I haven't got much time for a blah blah this time round, but in the next historical feature I will be giving you my email address and you can send me your true creepy tales. If I don't reply to you, and I probably won't, please understand, I will read them. Obviously it's just too time consuming for me to reply to you all. If I do use your story or intend to use your story, I will let you know. Yes, some of the actual images here were sent to me by Joe. That is actually the house. That is him and his little brother, the old photo, and him later also outside of the house with his brother as they were adults. And the photos in the window, they were the actual images on his phone. You know, I haven't just grabbed them from the internet. They are his actual images from his mobile phone. Just repeat once more, I haven't given you my email address yet, so don't ask me yet. It'll be in the next video, but get your stories ready, please. I'm looking forward to reading them, and should be interesting. Also, I want to start that t-shirt competition that I mentioned ages ago, so please get those designs ready, and once I give out my email address, then send them in. Just a recap on the t-shirt design competition. Still a bit vague at the moment, but basically draw a design for my channel. And I'll pick a winner. And we'll put it to a draw, actually. We'll let the viewers choose what they think are the best, probably three designs. So there'll be a first, second, and third winner. And I think I'll sort of think up of a prize for the first, second, and third, and also it will be on my online shop, available as a t-shirt for my viewers to buy, so that would be cool, I think. A bit of advertising for me, a bit of advertising for the winner, and I guess we could even get the second and third prize. They could also have their t-shirt in the shop as well. I'm still a bit sort of, as I say, vague on how the actual thing will work out. Maybe you can give me some ideas. I'm always open to suggestions. I'm going to actually head off now. I want to get this video out as soon as possible. There's probably more stuff I can ramble on about, but I'm sure there'll be plenty of other rambling opportunities during this new year, 2018. That's about it. Anyway, my friends, I'm heading out. Thank you for watching. Please thumb up, share it, subscribe, do all the stuff that's good, keeps me going. And I appreciate your support. Thank you, my friends. Bye-bye.